Hi guys, welcome. My name is Christian. I'm just to give you a quick bit of background, I'm based in Cape Town. I have a wife who lives in London. I travel the world a little bit doing things for CEDIA, which I thoroughly enjoy. And one of them which ties in very closely to it is obviously security and surveillance. Because I'm away from home often, because I'm away from my business often, I need to be able to keep tabs on things, not only from a personal perspective or a business perspective, but we have to look at being able to manage things remotely. We live in a world which has many, many influence factors on our industry, security being just one of them. We, as an industry, don't just hang televisions. We sell experiences. We enhance people's indulgences. We ensure that clients are able to live safely and securely in their own homes at the push of a button. At least that's what we profess we do. So 20 minutes is not a lot of time, and I'm going to be touching on a broad, very broad range of topics which are all somehow half related to security and surveillance and the changing landscape of our future. We've picked 2020 because it ties in a lot with what CEDIA is aiming for, and 2020 has always been a good year number to throw out there. It gives us enough time to scope the changes. So diving right in, I personally, like I said earlier, don't want to worry about the guy next door. I don't want to worry about what's happening there. I don't want to worry about someone spying on me, our privacy factors, someone pulling up in front of the garage at home or at our office, you know, double parking, stopping our activities from taking place. Does all of this sound familiar to you? Does it sound rich from people? You know, do you and do we profess to have clients who have massive, massive security systems and yet still can't functionally control them? Are we enhancing people's experiences of such systems with the solutions that we supply them? To give you a bit of a random introduction to this, there's a video which is quite profound for me personally, and it resonates very, very much with what we get involved with today, not only from a CCTV and surveillance perspective, but from a privacy factor. So without further ado, I'm going to hand it over to the screen.
What's your name?
Joelle.
What was your name?
Alex.
Alex. Thank you. Can you get your name? If you like our Facebook page, we give you a free hot drink and a free pastry.
We have a new line for Damien. We have a new line for Damien.
Hey, Carly, are you standing
by?
Hi there, can I help?
Yeah, I just liked your Facebook page.
Okay, I'll search Facebook.
I'm searching Google.
I have a phone number.
I've got his email address.
Okay, Carly, are you ready
for information on Damien?
Yep, I am.
Mother's maiden name is...
Where did you guys see UCL? Martin, they went to South Thames College. Assistant psychologist at Great Ormond Street.
You know I'm a Christian as well.
Oh, yeah, we know everything about you, Martin. Thank you. Nice to meet you, Anna from Russia.
As you can see from the video, that was predominantly aimed at fraud, and the awareness of the content and the access to information that is out there. It's one of the various myriad of topics that are encompassed by security of tomorrow. What is the status quo? What do we currently have? What do we currently sell? What do security systems encompass? Why do we have to have them? What are they good for? How are they implemented? Who benefits from them? As we all know, personal benefit from a security system and from a CCTV system, from cameras, from beams, from sensors around a home, They allow us to feel safe and secure. But our networks are a completely different story, yet form another layer of the security sort of cake. We have insurance companies, and Julie Jacobson, who did the previous presentation, touched on a number of these topics, which you'll actually see coming out here in the presentation again. Insurance companies is a fantastic topic to speak about in terms of security. As a South African, I have an argument with them very, very often. And it goes something along these lines. I have a really advanced CCTV system with analytical monitoring. I have beams, I have door pieces, I have sensors, we have triggers, everything. But our insurance premium is more than what it was last year. And if we add all of these extra devices, the premium actually just carries on going up, not down. So it's a discussion point that we can potentially address with them in our local market. How does that affect your markets? How does that affect global markets? These are very much discussion points for people to look out for in the future of tomorrow or the day of tomorrow, to go out and engage with people, to speak to them, to speak to your suppliers, to see how we can take the current status quo and change things. When we look at the current status quo of suppliers, we have the usual proponent of CCTV manufacturers all doing static display cameras, and a couple of them doing analytical cameras, which we'll touch on in a moment. What the status quo also covers is our current vendor practices. When we look at wiring topologies and what is required on network infrastructure, management, how do we implement all of these? These are the questions that we need to ask in order to be prepared for the security and surveillance industry of tomorrow. Maslow's hierarchy is one that we're all pretty familiar with. It comes up every now and then. And it basically stipulates that after food and shelter, our next jump is to security and safety. We want to feel safe. We want to feel secure. And it takes preference over pretty much everything else beyond that shelter and food requirement. In the modern age, I'd profess to also say that it needs to take place beyond Wi-Fi and battery life. But that's a different discussion point. What are the murky waters of the security system and surveillance landscape hold for us? What are the current market segments? Like we said, you know, CCTV forms just one of those. The questions to ask are, what types of cabling affect these systems? What types of information are they handling? What types of content are we dealing with? We should not be looking at networking the same ever again. What are the standard security practices? Do we simply cater for those alarm systems, those beams? Do we have massive systems controlled by Wi-Fi accessible cameras or door sensors or door locks? We'll touch on a couple of the additional items that have come on from the Internet of Everything on the next slide. But the business opportunities that arise for us as a CI industry or custom industry are various. Are our industries and are our businesses personally set up to cater solely and surely just for CCTV? Do we cater for analytics in environments like stores and retail environments? Are they just bolt-ons to the standard AV work that we do? Again, back in our market, it's an afterthought. Security tends to be very, very paramount, and the AV systems tend to come secondary. So a lot of CCTV manufacturers and suppliers and installers are engaged with audiovisual guys at a second level. The CCTV goes in first, and maybe we'll do a hi-fi system. Great. It could be a completely different market, and how you adapt to each of these will affect where you can take things in the future. A very important point, which actually came up in a brief R10 discussion, which a couple of you attended in the crowd this morning as well, was the fact that it doesn't matter how hard we install these systems, how well we install these systems, how well we look after the nature of the content on these systems for and on behalf of our clients, when they are the people behind the desk or between the keyboard and the chair who still end up clicking on the email from the poor Nigerian guy who's trying to give you some money. To give you a quick insight into the scope and size of this was specifically the UK market, in 2014 it was worth £1 billion. An interesting fact which I thought what resonated very much with me was the fact that security companies installing security has always grown, and it will continue to grow. This is 2013, 2014, and 2012 data. So we haven't actually factored in 2015 and 2016 at this point in time. But the growth is there, and it's year on year very, very steady. The interesting aspect comes in with your security systems based around professional monitoring or security systems where the customer is DIYing things. There's been a drop in the professional side, but there's been an increase in the customer side. And this comes from the advent of all those Internet of Fantastic Things, which we'll touch on again in a minute or a couple of slides. From a more localized perspective for you, how big is your industry? How big is the industry? Globally, Forbes has done some research, and I pinched some of their figures. But in the year 2020, we should be looking at a global market which is roughly at $170 billion in size. That is a massive, massive pie that we should all try and access. We should be adapting our businesses. We should be looking at how they can be implemented and changed and increased in order to access this. The US government has spent $1 billion, $100 billion on cybersecurity alone in the last 10 years. That's a fairly, fairly big number. And can you guess where it's going in the next 10 years? It's not just going to double. It'll potentially triple, if not quadruple, because of the exponential increase in all of these gadgets and devices. Some of the things to bear in mind with your businesses and how you can adapt to the future is ultimately looking at implementation for the times and occurrences of data lapses, data breaches, the cost per breach. It's a very important point to consider that no system is going to be infallible. It's not a case of if someone breaks into the system, it's a case of when they break into the system. So we had some murky water earlier with everything that covers, and this is what's lurking beneath. What is encompassing in our industry? We have that dreaded Internet of Everything, the Internet of Things, or as I'd like to call it, the Internet of cheap alternatives. We have massive, massive devices that come out on Indiegogo. We've got Dropcam, we've got Canary, we've got August Lock, we've got Alarm.com. Everyone is getting into the security market. Everyone wants to protect you. But what are they not telling you? What are they not giving away? What are they not indicating very, very explicitly right up front? How are the DIY integrations of these devices and cameras influencing our security and our personal security and our privacy? Are we looking at the correct bandwidth issues, especially with things that are Wi-Fi connected? Are we looking at privacy issues? What are the cost implications for any of our installers or integrators? When we look at as Julie touched on in the previous presentation, there are guys out there installing systems for $1,100, and $550 is what they're charging to do so. How many businesses can survive on that? How are we implementing our margin structures? How are we actually looking after our bottom line? We have to take all of this into consideration. We have to manage the expectations of the end user and the client. And those opportunities, to touch back to the bandwidth resolution and the current connectivity and information that's going over your network, we can look at analytics. We can analyze all the information and the traffic going onto those networks. So the drop cams, the August locks, the alarm.coms, they're not in it for your security. They're not in it to look after you. That's a secondary benefit. They are there to gather big, big data. The more information that they have on you, the better they can advertise, the better they can target you, the better that they can make sure that you're constantly connected. We very much look at an age of abundance when it comes to this information coming out of these devices. And getting back to the analytical cameras aspect of it, we live in a society or an environment which has, up until today, been very much a reactive system. If you think of the classic CCTV system today, and you think of people moving about, jumping over the fence, quickly breaking into your house, stealing some stuff and disappearing, what happens? We analyze that the following day. We realize that there's been a breach. We only attempt to fix things the day after, or retrospectively, or after the case in point. Many of these systems, not only CCTV systems using analytical factors or data or implementation, allow us to proactively approach these topics. We can increase our security by becoming more aware of what's happening around us all the time. The old school CCTV systems tend to be aware of what's going on you, but someone needs to sit behind a desk. Someone needs to monitor it. Someone needs to look at that picture pretty much all the time. When you start feeding analytics into it, that can happen reactive to when the actual transgression takes place. You can also take into consideration that your big data in this field is coming from things like heat mapping. Constantly connected shoppers are walking through a store and they are accessing certain aisles and shops. And we can, as a business, go out to new consumers, new clients, new end users and say to them, well, we have systems which will allow you to map out within your store where the most foot traffic takes place. We can use all of that information in various industry sectors to predict what can happen next. How does this again relate back to us and our businesses? What can we do in the future? Can we advise our clients on upgrades to their WhatsApp? New terms and conditions which allow people to or service providers to access information on our phones. How many of you have Facebook Messenger on your devices? Pretty much all of you. You've sold your souls. Walt, you're the special case, we know. There was recently a big outcry on WhatsApp because obviously we know that WhatsApp is owned by Facebook and they want access to all of your data. And if you did an upgrade about 3-4 weeks ago and you just blindly pressed yes, and how many of us do that? We blindly just press yes. Fine, we're happy to give away that information. It happens in a heartbeat and it gives them access to pretty much everything. So is this going to generate a society where we value privacy and our security? Absolutely. What does the future hold? Do we have a differing opinion? No one here is below the age of 10. But I can guarantee if we ask someone who is below the age of 10, their privacy concerns are practically non-existent. They live online. They live in a cyber world. They have no concept of privacy. They've got no concept of security. I profess to think of a couple of aspects of how this changing landscape could affect us. And it's a prediction which we've spoken about or thought of and discussed at the technology forums and technology council meetings, where with the increase in speed and data transfer, the increase in the decrease in size of devices, the increase in intelligence of those devices, I could potentially, in the near future, walk over to you, pick up your phone, have my fingerprint scan onto your phone, and immediately it becomes mine. It has my data and my content on, but the minute I hand it back to you, it becomes yours again. How does that sort of technology and that outlook change the way that we need to think about the systems that we install today and tomorrow? Do we sell separate systems? Do we sell individual systems? Bringing it down to a basic Wi-Fi level or a networking level in a home, do we sell a system which is unprotected versus a system which is completely locked down? Again, a point that I picked up from our discussions earlier this morning, when you look at big corporate companies, they have whitelists and blacklists. If you go to the office, you can't access Facebook. Job done. Not allowed to. There are only certain things that you can do on that network. Whereas from a home or a residential perspective, we tend to try and ask our clients and say, well, you know, what do you want? You want to block some porn sites from your children? Great, we'll put that in there. There's loopholes, there's ways and means around that. So instead of having a blanket stoppage of any of those websites access, we're contrasting that with which ones do you want to block out? And it's looking at the alternatives between the two and advising your clients correctly as to what the best practice is for the future. So, yes, what is that coming over the hill? What is the changing landscape of what we're doing? We're still specialists. We focus on technology. We sell the devices to the clients that some of the other guys can't. We need to still sell the experience with those devices. We need to be able to tap into bigger corporate markets. We need to look at how we can take our systems that we are doing on a small scale and tap into a bigger market. We have a number of opportunities that are coming up in the CCTV security landscape and cyberspace. And there will be a number of publications that continue to evolve over the next couple of years where CEDIA is intrinsically involved in. We can adapt our businesses to do very cool things. We currently do audio video. Discussion I've had with a number of clients, and we've run this out there just as a joke, incidentally. But imagine setting the scene and saying to yourself, I've got a security system, I've got a fairly big garden, I like a bit of sound outside, I like good lighting. Integrating those three alongside your security, your perimeter beams, and everything, what would happen if a burglar climbed over the wall, got past the fence, and in the middle of the night, or 3 a.m., whatever time it was, the opening sequence of Saving Private Ryan came pumping out over the loudspeakers in the garden. The lights went all flash bang. There were air cannons pumping out some air with some soil and everything. And it's a laughable scenario, absolutely. But how would that affect the guy jumping over the fence? He'd never want to do it again. He'd be scared, absolutely, and he wouldn't do it. If that's a deterrent, who knows? If it's a gimmick, absolutely. But it gives you an idea of all the small little things that you can pull together and you can try and give to a client. You can propose things like that to them. We have a very, very different view of crime and security in South Africa and in Africa as you do to America. Julie was just saying, you know, how many of us leave our doors unlocked? How many of us leave the cars unlocked? Theft isn't necessarily a massive, massive deterrent or a factor in the US, but it is in other places. And if we really do want to become a global industry and a global reaching organization, we need to be able to, from CEDIA's perspective, advise businesses on their best practices, no matter where they are. Where do we move on from here? If we look at some of the stats which has been collected, the age of adaptive intelligence and of super intelligence is around the corner. Ray Kurzweil is a name that crops up very, very often in our discussions. And he's always been quoted and said, ever expanding. What is around the corner? We currently go from a standard or stock standard, and we refer to CCTV again, but CCTV and alarm system. And where does this go from there? Does it still stay that reactive system? Does it progress to a proactive system? Does it step up to a self-aware system? Do we already include a lot of this with the systems that we sell? Are we concerned about the freely available personal information that's out there? As you saw in the video earlier, a simple Facebook like is enough to garner a treasure trove of information for fraudsters, personality thieves, guys who want to hack your systems, people who want to clone your identity. There are plenty, plenty of examples out there in the world where things like this happen all the time. Before we get to the end of the presentation, there were a couple of really, really quirky, again, very much like the South Africanized alarm system, analogies that I looked into. Who here has read the book Freakonomics? There are fantastic parallels drawn between things which are completely and utterly, in our opinion, unrelated. And I think relating to the security and surveillance industry of tomorrow is very much like one of those comparisons. We can work as hard as possible to encourage people to install the systems that are of a specific standard, of a specific type, of a specific requirement and end game, so to speak. But we don't know what else happens outside of the scope of our work. And one story which particularly touched me with the Freakonomics was basically the long and short of it was that the introduction of abortion realized a decrease in crime rates 15 to 18 years later. Two completely irrelevant things linked over a period of time that we had no control over. We thought we had no control over. And this could be related to the security industry as well. The stuff that we do today can have a massive, massive impact on where things go tomorrow. How we look after that, that's down to you guys and to the installers and the dealers to ask the right questions, to make alliances, to partner with the right people, to speak to the companies that you're already dealing with. Some of us might be small-scale installers who just focus on audiovisual work. Some of us might be guys who already encompass security. We do networking, we do surveillance. We're a jack of all trades. Hopefully not a master of none. But we need to look at all of these scenarios and we need to ask the right questions of the clients. We need to be able to have intimate knowledge of products, how they operate, how they can integrate, and how we can make sure that those integrations benefit the wider community around us, inside our homes, and with our loved ones. So basically, without further ado, that's pretty much me done. Thank you for attending. I hope I've given you at least some insight or some ideas of questions to ask. I know the presentation was sort of slightly disconnected, but it's a very, very, very broad topic. And there is so much information out there. It does get very difficult to encompass it into a short presentation. Thank you.